whole, which, by the way, is like think of use cases like if you want to like mask the lower lip of a mouth, it's like this is exactly the shape you want through the corners of the mouth. So for those kind of cases, like, this is super useful. You can switch to 2 to have this shape, you can switch to have this other shape with the 3 key, and with the 4 key you see that it no longer detects the hole. So it's the difference between this and this. That's completely up to you and depends on what you want. But there's also another feature of Expand that is automatic boundary detection. Okay, so if you start the mask from any place, it's going to like start with a circle shape. But if you start exactly on a vertex that's a boundary, it's going to create a mask through that boundary. And the same with a facet. Which, by the way, is like you don't need to click exactly on the boundary. It's like if you click a little bit outside, it's also going to work, as you can see here. So it's like it's not that precise. It's like it has some kind of threshold. Okay, so now you know the basic of Expand, but there's like one more thing for the basics. You know that when you use a gesture tool like the box mask, you can press the spacebar and move the box. Now for Expand, you can start expanding the mask, press the spacebar, and it's going to move the shape through the surface. And this is not a projection, it's like this is actually moving the shape through the surface. Because if I'm in perspective, you see that it moves through the surface. It's not a view projection. And you can like change the shape and continue like moving it through the surface. And with what I explained before, like you can like create new shapes and start building whatever you want. Okay, so it's like, those are kind of the, for me, that was the MVP for Expand, like the minimum features that I wanted to have to improve what was already there. But now it's like where things start going, where things start getting really interesting. There's a new feature in Expand that's called facet editing. So first, let me expand a couple of facets. No particular order. Nope. Here. Okay, before that there was the tool that was called facet edit that allows you like to click on a facet and it was going to grow the facet like one step. Okay. But now with expand you can do this. You can click on a facet and resize it in an interactive way, and you can even delete facets from the mesh. As you can see, the feel of the facets is content aware, so if you decide to resize this facet, it's going to feel green and the purple facet is going to disappear. So yeah, now you can resize and delete faces dynamically, and we are going to look later, like what's the point of creating like circles and resizing them. Going to show you the what is this for. But also there's another feature that's called facet snapping. So if you have another set of facets and you start expanding a mask, if you press the control key, the mask is going to snap to entire facets. So if you want to create a mask that fills this facet, you can just shift A, control, and it's going to fill that facet. Control, you can flip it, and you have it. Okay. So now, it's like, going to show you one of the most common complaints about the PostBrush and how this improves this. How this improves that. One of the things that people that use the PostBrush, which is a tool that is more designed to be semi-automatic, is that when you use topologies, like, you can really control the origin of the PostBrush to an exact position through the geometry. But with Expand, you can now use the existing faced mode of the PostBrush. You can take Expand in this vertex and expand a mask. And now the origin of the PostBrush is going to snap to that area. And if you want the origin exactly there, you can have the origin exactly there. But not only that, with the facet editing capability, you can resize this facet and slide the origin through the mesh as much as you want. So if you want complete control of the PostBrush in like cylindrical surfaces and like tails or fingers or things like that, you can actually do it now. And on top of that, for now that this is a development preview, I'm also working on a new deformation mode that is called Bend, which does this. So you can bend here, you can move the origin there, you can bend here again, you can move the origin there, and you can bend this part with complete control of what you're doing. Okay, so now I'm going to show you a more practical case. Like, probably one of the most painful things to do with sculpting software is reshaping hands and posing hands. But Blender has this feature that can initialize facets from the UVs of a mesh, which kind of creates a pattern that can simulate a grid. So, if you set the PostBrush to topologies, not going to have like any particular control over what you're doing. But if you set it to faces, let's say that we can pose the thumb. Okay, so you can pose from there and from here. That is what makes sense. And you can rotate by pressing the control key. So it's like, this is kind of having a rig where you can like quickly pose and change the shape of the hand. But now with Expand, what you can do is like, let's say that you have this shape of the thumb and you like it. So you want to remove this join. You can grow this facet and at the same time snap it to the other one so it removes that join. So now the thumb moves as a block and you are not going to be able to deform that anymore. It's like it's kind of masking the shape of the finger, but you can still pose it. But let's say you want this joint back. It's like you don't really need to go through the UVs anymore and initialize all the faces, because from scale mode you can hide everything else, and Expand is going to detect this as a boundary, so you can expand a facet from there and you can get that origin back. And not only that, but you know that I was also working on Keymesh with Daniel Martinez Lara, and he was like using Expand, like the old version of Expand, to kind of simulate the rigs, the selections of a rig, to use the transfer tools for animations and being able to animate a mesh without a rig. Now with Expand, if you start expanding from a finger and you press Control, you can select the facets. But not only that, but it's going to put the origin of the transfer tool in there, so you can pose the finger with animations controls if you want to. And if you want like to pose the entire hand, it's as easy as going with the Expand, select everything you want to pose, and then you can pose it. And I deformed the hand in a very weird way, but hope this gives you an idea. Okay, let's continue because there's a lot more for this. Okay, so this was kind of like new feature for Expand, which is facet editing and facet snapping, which by the way is like probably the, because I'm going to use this later, so I would like you to have this clear. If you create facets with the Shift Alt W key, you enter edit mode of the facet the cursor is over. And by pressing Control, you can snap that facet you are modifying to the previous one. And this kind of allows you to merge one facet into another. And that's the base of like moving the pivot point and controlling properly the auto-masking options from faucet boundaries, because right now you can actually delete this boundary if you merge this facet into this one. That was kind of the idea. But okay, the next feature for Expand is what gives it the, is what gives it the power for the pattern creation. So probably like environment artists are going to like everything that I'm going to show you from now a lot. So you start expanding the mask and it is just going to create a boundary in the mask. But if you press the W and Q keys, the W is for increase and the Q key is for decrease, it's going to clone the expansion in a loop pattern. And you can still change the shape live, you can flip it, and you can move it. And again, this is all working in 3D. This is working through the surface. So you can have this, and you can move this. It's like, okay, most basic thing you can do with this is like, now you can create things like this in an instant. But this is not it. Okay. This is basically the feature that allows you to model hard surface patterns really, really quickly. And we're going like to model some of those, some of like complex ones that require all the features later. But okay, I'm not sure if I should show you this now, or this is clear, but okay, let's continue a little bit more. Note that you know that you can create a mask and increase the loop count and decrease it. There's another feature that is called gradients, which works with the G key. So with the G key, the area of the mask that is going to be filled is going to be filled with a gradient instead of with a constant mask. If you flip it, mask is going to grow from there. And this is also working with all the other modes and the loop functionality. So when you can create masks like this with a linear gradient, you can start creating shapes like this. But now I'm going to show you like how you can combine this with the previous features. Okay, let's say we have like a subdivided cylinder like this, and we want to create a hard surface pattern with the tools we know for now. Okay, so you start from the boundary around here, it's like it doesn't have to be perfect, and you start expanding a mask. But let's say you don't want it to be like in this shape, you want to be triangle. So you change to the other shape, you can make a square, you can make a sphere, whatever you want. And now you create multiple loops through the surface. And now you can enable the gradient and you have kind of something like this. And you can keep like tweaking the loop count, tweaking the shape, and all the options are preserved. Okay, so now if you go to the mesh filter and you select it to inflate, you kind of have this hard surface shape. but you can continue from here. You can go to this end of the shape.